This is a fan commentary for the 2015 film Spectre, starring Daniel Craig and Christoph Waltz and Léa Seydoux and, to a slightly lesser degree, Ralph Fiennes, directed by Sam Mendes and written by John Logan, Neil Purvis, Robert Wade, Jez Butterworth, from a story by John Logan, Neil Purvis, and Robert Wade, based on characters created by Ian Fleming. A lot of people helped write this. It is a James Bond film, and it is a big, big blockbuster. It did very well. People were very pleased with it as a follow-up to Skyfall, which did very, very well. That was a follow-up to the rather disappointing, but still actually not a bad film, Quantum of Solace. And then before that, Casino Royale, which was one of the really good ones. I think, well, with Skyfall, we got back on track. And I don't love the Daniel Craig films. Casino Royale is really good. The rest of them are good. This one is also good. But they're not really in contention for my favorite of the Bond films, partly because Craig himself is kind of, well, no, I mean, the character is written as a little dull, in my opinion, and the villains are written as a little dull. But here's what we're going to do. We're going to start the film with I think it's the Columbia logo after the MGM logo. So the first frame of black that you perceive after the MGM logo, pause it there, and we're going to start on a countdown. The music actually sort of has already started. We kind of have a lull there between the two logos, and then we go on. So I think everybody should have the same version of this. I'm watching on Blu-ray, naturally. I highly recommend that you own the film, and really all the Bond films on Blu-ray. Really, don't trust that these are going to be available on, you know, streaming video or something, whatever, on, you know, brain implants, whatever you have in the future. Buy it on Blu-ray, own it, you know, listen to the commentaries and stuff. But let's go. 3, 2, 1, go. This is kind of a lengthy film, a little longer than an action film really needs to be. Anything longer than about 2:10 is, in my opinion, a little too long for an action film. I can't remember if I've ever said that before, but it's true. It's what I believe. It's in my heart. So this film, of course, obviously brings back Spectre and brings back Ernst Stavro Blofeld. This was only possible after a substantial deal with the whoever owned the rights. It was the estate of Kevin McClory, because he helped to create the character and so on. The dead are alive, it says. Ooh, it's Dia de Muertos here festival, keeping with the other Bond films, in that whenever he goes to a foreign country, there's always a local festival, at least South America anyway, Mexico City. And, but of course that line, the dead are alive, becomes a bit of a theme in the rest of the film, because, obviously we're going to learn that, Blofeld is somebody from Bond's past who, Bond thought was dead. Now, but also there are other elements as well. Mr. White, it turns out, escaped, and he's been killed, and he's walking dead, as it were. He ends up killing himself because he's been poisoned and so on. And so there are other elements along the way. And the 00 program gets killed, and yet it still lives, and so on. There's themes that go on all the way through. But mostly it's about the fact that Blofeld is somebody from Bond's past whom he believed to be dead. There's a problem with that, which is that we didn't really know anything about that character, so it's not like a huge reveal. Instead, in fact, it's a backwards reveal, because by the time, like, he recognizes Blofeld and he's like saying, like, look up this name even after he was dead, find out what happened to him after he was dead. Like, what? And we go, where did he come up with that name? And only later, much later, do we learn that it's because he recognized him because he's his childhood foster brother. And it's just, in my opinion, kind of terrible. Because it cheapens the Blofeld character. I mean, if you're going to do that, then why make him Blofeld, right? You could write him with any name, really. It also has a creates a problem in that it makes Blofeld another person who is kind of an insider who gone bad. And of course, see Max Denby in this film is another insider gone bad. And you know, if you've listened to any of my commentaries, James Bond or not, how much I hate the insider gone bad villain. It is way overused and I am really sick of it. But as soon as I saw, what's his name? Andrew Scott. Is that his name? Who plays, Max Denby. Is that his name? I'm looking these things up. Yeah. Andrew Scott. As soon as I saw him, I went, oh, I hate that guy. Oh, yeah, I hate that guy. Because I pre-hated him from Sherlock because he played Moriarty, and I frankly did not care for that characterization very much. So, oh, well. Now, that was a weird little thing. Like, they apparently did that for real, where he took off that that costume when we were looking at her. And the question is, why? Like, what was the point of that? Apparently the whole point of it is that this is an unbroken shot and like, ooh, aren't you impressed that this is an unbroken shot? And the answer is no, not really, not anymore. Now that I can physically hold in my own hand a Canon EOS camera that, yes, it's not a production quality movie camera, you know, but it's a high definition camera. I can hold in my hand and carry it wherever I want. No, I'm not impressed that you do an unbroken shot like this. Because I know that, you can do stuff like that with certain kinds of cameras. So, it's nice. It's okay. At night, it flows nicely and everything, but I'm not going to be impressed by it. Don't imagine that I will be, any more than I will be by a building that falls down. Although, okay, I actually really am. What's coming up is actually really, really cool. That's a great gun. I didn't look up the guns in this movie. I don't know if that's a real gun, but it looks very cool. I was very confused by this upcoming scene here, this scene that we're in. At first, because I didn't quite get the giveaway, I didn't quite get what was going on at all. I mean, obviously, he's listening in on these guys. I don't know how he's listening in. I guess he's got a telescopic microphone built into that, into the gun or something. I'm not sure. I'm not sure I want a microphone built into my gun right? Because that would make a big noise in your ear when the gun fired, but whatever. Okay. Maybe it's on some kind of a thing where if you pull the trigger, I don't know. But here we go. He blows smoke and he sees the blue laser. That's what it was, the laser sight, which is very clumsy of Bond, by the way. That's Bond's own dumb fault, frankly. But it's also confusing because it's blue instead of red. Most of the gun lasers are red. It's kind of cool that it's blue, but it's silly. I mean, that's a mistake to use it in that way. And then Bond, they shoot, and I guess he blew up the bomb, and that bomb blew out the building. And then somehow that bomb was so big it took this building down, and I'm supposed to believe that bomb was going to take down a whole stadium or something. This is all like, it's okay once I think about it, but at the time that the scene is playing out, I'm like, wait, what happened? What's going on here? Why is this happening? But the way this plays out is fairly spectacular. We get a little bit of humor there, falling onto the couch. Most of the film, there's not a whole lot of humor in the film, so enjoy that and enjoy the C word joke later on, because there's not much in between. Here we go. There is Sciara. How that guy escaped the bomb going off right in front of him and the building collapsing all around him, I don't know. And then he's got the presence of mind to see Bond and go, well, that must be the guy who is responsible for this mess. Oh, well, whatever. This looks terrific. I do love it feels like we've done the Day of the Dead in another Bond film, but Maybe, I guess we haven't. We did Carnival. We did something in Live and Let Die. The voodoo, I guess I'm mixing up the Carnival scenes and the voodoo stuff. This is not the real carnival of the Day of the Dead. They apparently created all of this more or less from scratch. These dresses are terrific. We're about to see right here. They apparently made these up again from scratch, and they put these women on like the hoverboard, electric skateboards. I believe is how they did that. It's a really neat thing, but it's not the sort of thing that you'd see in the real festival. It's just made for the movie. And it's another case of the bad guy being able to slip away in the crowd. And, of course, get to his helicopter that's going to land in the middle of the crowd? Apparently, I don't know, he had an app that he called for Uber helicopter, and here it comes. Landing in the middle of the carnival for some reason. And I like how the guy is like having to push his way through the people, even though, you know, the helicopter's, the helicopter doesn't know where he is, right? So it's just going to land in the middle and hope that people get out of its way. And then he has to get to the helicopter at the same time. That sort of makes sense, I guess. I like the fact that Bond has to grab a makeshift weapon. And these guys dancing are like, well, I don't know if that helicopter's part of the show or what, but I'm just going to keep on dancing. I got my dance to dance. I'm going to dance it. But then I love this whole sequence is so spectacular. I love this because it all looks real. I mean, I'm completely sold on it, and it's absolutely terrifying. The screams from the crowd below are what sell it for me too, because that is exactly, well, I don't think I'd be screaming. I think I would just be going, you know what? I am going to get inside of a very, sturdy stone building at this point, because that helicopter is going down. There is no situation in which a helicopter spinning around backwards ends well. I mean, first of all, dozens of people would be trampled trying to get out of the way of where they think the helicopter is going to crash, number one. So, you know, count that on the death toll for this film. Not that too many people die in this film. Even though there are some buildings that do come down. A couple. This is very strange to me. I thought, maybe did I miss something? But on second viewing, second, third, fourth viewing, I don't think I did miss anything. Like, he just grabs this guy's ring for no reason I can think of. I can't imagine why he even noticed it. It's very strange. It would be different if he specifically saw the guy. Did he see the guy like compare rings in the room before? I don't think that's what happened. It would also be different if he grabbed the guy's hand and the guy like slipped out of his hand and fell to the ground, and all that was left was the ring. Like, that would be sort of interesting too. But it looked like he just goes, "Hey, that guy's wearing a ring." Like, surprise, a guy in Mexico City is wearing a man in Mexico City is wearing a ring. Oh well. And then now, why are we killing the Uber driver at this point? What? He's just a helicopter pilot, for Pete's sake. When has a helicopter pilot ever done anybody any wrong? Other than, you know, I don't know, Vietnam or whatever, you know, whatever. And this is a very, very tough job to fly a helicopter. He should not be fighting and punching and kicking the guy and whatnot. Is very unfair. They should just make it. They should make a handshake deal to land safely, and that and they would both survive. There's no way the helicopter pilot signed on to risk his life in this situation. There are definitely people who died being trampled to death just getting out of Bond's way, right there. There we go. Ba-ba-da-da. Bum-ba-ba. I don't know why that reminds me of A-Team at that point, but I like the little smile on his face. Now I have a helicopter. I guess I own this helicopter now. I can go anywhere I want. Let me more closely examine this ring whilst flying a helicopter. And here we go into a rather good credit sequence. It includes Bond. Not many of the credit sequences in the James Bond films include Bond. They were usually made separately, sometimes with an actor in silhouette, sort of portraying Bond. But here we get Daniel Craig himself topless for some reason. I don't know why people would want to see him topless. I don't know. Is it? I don't know why that would be the case. He, you know, is participating in this. I like the, obviously, since we were using the ring motif of the octopus, we get to use all kinds of tentacles and stuff, which I have to imagine this plays very well in Asia, this whole sequence. Nearly nude women writhing with tentacles surrounding them. And the tentacles look so good, don't they? Oh, they look fantastic and delicious, in fact. They look terrific. Here we see little snippets of characters from the previous films to remind us of those characters, so that later on when Blofeld says, this and that, all that that happened, it was all me. I've been torturing you because I didn't like you from when we were kids. My daddy liked you best, and that really got under my nerves, so I killed my father. And then I've slowly been torturing you. I built up a giant criminal empire. It's very confusing. It reduces the effectiveness of the character, in my opinion. Blofeld is a criminal mastermind. If you want to write a different character that is not a criminal mastermind, that is out for revenge against James Bond for something that happened in childhood, A, that's dumb, and B, just write him as a different character. If you had told me that Blofeld was going to be played by Christoph Waltz, I would have said, oh my God, that is a perfect choice. That is so fantastic. He's kind of theatrical in all of his other roles. And then here we see him. He is his least theatrical. I've never seen Christoph Waltz less interesting. I don't know what he was thinking or what the director was thinking. Because he is not, I mean, holy mackerel. This is where you ramp it up, man. And he really kept it under wraps. We'll get to him. Eventually I will do my imitation of Christoph Waltz that will be fun. I don't know what the deal is with the flame. We get the flame, and then I guess we get, is that water or a waterfall or snow or something? I'm not sure. We're mixing our metaphors here at this point. There's also something about that ring that reminds me a little bit too much of the League of Criminals, the League of Crime or whatever from the 1966 Batman movie. Here is Ralph Fiennes as M. I really like Ralph Fiennes. In general, I like Ralph Fiennes. I like him in particular. I like this version of M quite a bit. I did enjoy Judi Dench during her reign, but I like that they brought in this guy. They really went old school. I mean, really, really went old school with this guy. I mean, he's really very, very, very British, you know. He's very, oh, wow, we're very old school sort of fellow, you know. Nah, yeah. There's things that he does with his mouth that are downright medieval. I've said this before. I don't care for Bond as the rogue. It's mainly because it's done so often with so many other action movies. You know, oh, you're a loose cannon, Bond. You're too close to this case. I'm taking you off the case. Don't go anywhere near. You got 24 hours, Bond. That, you know, all of that stuff is, you know, don't leave the country. Don't go poking your nose into this, or I'll chew your ass out. And I don't like that. The one thing I've always said, the thing about Bond that makes him more interesting than most other action characters is the way that he's kind of a company man, and he gets an assignment, he goes and he follows up on that assignment. He may go, you know, during the course of that assignment, he may go a bit off, but this is a very funny little moment. I don't know why he calls him C. It's as if, like, I don't know, they sort of act like we should expect that he would call him C because of his position, but that's not real as far as I can tell. Ian Fleming just made up the idea that M was called M based on some people that he knew who, you know, signed themselves as M and whose names happened to start with M and that kind of thing. It's not like an official designation for MI5 and MI6 directors, as far as I know. It's all made up by Ian Fleming, but they act like, oh, well, of course he would be called C, even though his name is Max Denby. So I don't quite get that. You know, the quartermaster is called Q because he's a quartermaster, I guess. I think that's just made up by Ian Fleming. So it's an odd thing, but I do really, really like the way that, Bond, the way that Daniel Craig plays that moment of, I guess we should call you C, and he says, oh no, don't bother. Don't, no, call me Max. And it's like, no, I'm a call you C. It's a moment that kind of helps cement the relationship between Bond and M, which of course needs to be strong later on when they literally take up arms. They can become brothers in arms together. That's quite something. It feels like there was a scene missing between Bond saying, show up at my place at 9 p.m. and then her showing up at his place at 9 p.m. That feels very awkward. And I don't know if there was a scene missing, but it's a weird way to cut because it suggests that Bond had something to do that was important right at that moment. Of course, what actually happened, the real reason for this is that he wants to show her the video. How exactly this works, I don't know. He had the TV turned on and now he started a videotape or something? How do you make that come up automatically with one touch of a button? I don't get it. Find a man called Marco Sciarra, kill him, and don't miss the funeral. This is part of the problem with this film. There's a lot of things that just go unexplained. And I feel like I might be missing something. Certainly, the fact that Bond knows who Blofeld is something that is revealed later on, like how that is the case. But how does M know who Sciarra is and that he needs to be killed and so on? And why, if that's the case, then why would she only give him that assignment after she was killed? Why not give it to him beforehand? Why not pass it on to the next M instead of giving it to Bond specifically, right? Things like that, you know, are very convenient for the filmmakers, but are simply flatly cheats when it comes to screenwriting. There is the little English bulldog that I think belonged to M and was her gift to him. Here we go with some of Bond's past from Skyfall. Order of Temporary Guardianship. Master James Bond. And here we are. So the head that is cropped out, well, burned out on the right-hand side, that would be Blofeld. That would be Oberholzer. Oberhauser, right? Franz Oberhauser. So it's burned out so that we don't recognize so that we don't recognize Christoph Waltz, because even as a young man, we see a clip of him later, even as a young man, he looked just like Christoph Waltz. Cheaper to knock her down than to rebuild, because yeah, the old MI6 headquarters was destroyed severely damaged in the previous films. The new center from National Security, there it is. Oh, it looks fantastic, doesn't it? That's C's new digs. Classic Whitehall Mandarin. Radossia about how the 00 should be, 00 work should be done by drones. This is Bill Tanner, by the way, if you don't remember him. We've seen him in several other movies. And he's always a good influence. I wish that characters like this would get used a little bit more, or in a little bit more of a characteristic way, or something else that would tie them together. You know, I mean, it would help. Number one, if Bond shook his hand and called him Bill, for example, stuff like that. A train bombing in Hamburg and an industrial explosion in Tunisia. It's all rather playing into C's hands. Ah, and we're going to find out that it's actually all not orchestrated by C himself, but rather orchestrated by Blofeld. It would be interesting if it turned out that C was somehow being manipulated by Blofeld, and even he did not know. And in actuality, he was just a dupe, and control at the crucial moment when he activates Nine Eyes, I think that's what it's called, right? Nine Eyes, yeah. At that crucial moment that control is wrested from him, and Blofeld has it, or is able to, you know, snake his way in and access the system without C knowing, and C and Q together somehow discover that's what's happening, and then he becomes, I don't know, turns around and becomes a good guy and blah, 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 blah. But that's not what happens. They just go, no, he's on the bad guy's side. You know, he's another insider. Somehow this Whitehall Mandarin was recruited by Blofeld and has been working all this time, working his way up to become the director of intelligence of Great Britain. And he all this time he's been working for Blofeld for some reason. I don't know why that would be the case. Money, I don't know that Max is rich. I don't know. This is a really, really creepy thing. Like, here you go, just to, you know, we're just going to put this in your arm, and now we can track you anywhere in the world. Oh my God. The one thing that Bond would not be on board with as a company man would be being tracked wherever he goes all over the world. This is a very silly moment here. Oh, look. It's a beautiful thing, isn't it? We were going to give it to you, but no, it's been reassigned to 009. So here you go. Here's a watch. okay, this is really all just a setup for Bond stealing it later then, right? But again, that's Bond going rogue, and the whole idea of the Quartermaster is the Quartermaster gives Bond his gadgets to go, you know? it's painful in a lot of ways. Like, they insist on having this character in here, but they're like, we don't want to have that scene where Bond is given gadgets by Q, that, you know, and it's like, oh, and then he uses all those gadgets. So, but we're still going to have Q, and he still kind of does give Bond gadgets, but Bond, you know, steals it from him. Like, the whole point of a quartermaster is that's where you get your stuff. Use that character that way, or don't use the character at all. It's kind of dumb. And it would be okay, except that this is the way that all action heroes seem to act nowadays. Right? They're not just going to get the thing. They're going to steal it from their boss or the guy who's supposed to have it or whatever. There was a moment, he says that he's got a couple of cats here. So that's not, he's not married. There was a moment later on that I thought that Moneypenny's boyfriend was him, but apparently it's not. It's another guy, another actor, which, I don't know if that's better or worse. I don't know if it's better or worse that I thought it was him and it's not him, or I don't know. Again, you know, maybe it would be too much and I would go, oh, stop entangling these characters. Keep them separate. They don't, not everything needs to be tied together. That's probably how I would react. So, but nevertheless, I thought for a moment that that's who that was. And here is a bit of a cell phone. I don't know why. Where does Bond get a cell phone to give her in the first place? I don't know. I guess it's a burner, right? I guess. Oh, yeah, 009. He's waiting upstairs to take the DB10. He's just sitting there drinking a cup of coffee, waiting for Q to get in the morning? This is what you do? You have your 00 agents sit around waiting? Why does he show up so early? Why would you expect? I don't know. But of course it's gone. Somehow Bond sneaked in, broke into Q's headquarters, the quartermaster of British intelligence. Somehow Bond got past his security. Of course, well, apparently there is no security because everybody just seems to walk into that joint whenever they feel like it. And that is, by the way, some of the worst pimping I've ever seen. Those switches with the tape. Boy, that was just really clumsy. Let's take a $100,000 car and probably more than that, as a matter of fact, DB10. Geez, I don't know. And put these, you know, 59-cent switches on the dashboard. Like, what if I have to give somebody a ride? They'll ask me what that means. Backfire? What is that switch that says backfire? This is a very odd scene. It's reminiscent of, gosh, what is it? I want to say Thunderball. Is that the one that starts with the fake funeral or the woman that turns out to be a man? That's Blofeld right there, I guess. So that, I guess, serves as our meeting between Bond and the villain early on. Normally in the old days, in the old formula, which was itself a little little tired, I'm happy to admit, Bond would typically meet the villain early on and in ineffectual meetings. They just kind of sized each other up, and sometimes the villain decided to try to kill Bond right away. He decided he was dangerous right away. Sometimes nothing came of it, and Bond was able to insinuate himself into the a little closer to the villain's organization and so on. But typically, you know, they'd meet over a game of baccarat or something like that. But I guess that serves as that moment. He has a very interesting and very pointed conversation with her. It's not immediately apparent that she is aware that she's going to be killed by the organization, by Spectre. That little wave, the cock of his head and a little wave is very funny. It's a good, nice moment, and well shot, very well framed and everything. I can't quite think of any other Bond actor who would do that or who would look right doing that. Certainly Roger Moore would talk to that guy and have some sort of cheeky little exchange with him. But away from a distance, I don't know, maybe Sean Connery? Maybe? Brosnan would also like, you know, he would be very happy to do a little cheeky little comment to the guy directly, but not a not a wave like that. It's a bit of whimsy that is, I guess, indicative of Daniel Craig's less verbal version of Bond. This is a beautifully shot scene. Again, a lot of this movie is really quite handsome. Here we get Monica Bellucci walking through the house and ostensibly coming down from a stressful day, but then we slowly realize, and we think, you know, being stalked, and oh no, she has no idea, but in fact she's actually fully aware of what's going on, and she's not, this is in her mind, you know, her last moments, and we get a little dark humor in the way that Bond takes these guys out, and then just strolls up to her while she thinks she still might be dead. "What a lovely view," he says. "There are 100 more that will come after me. All you buy me is 5 minutes. Excellent. Time for a drink." Monica Bellucci was, I believe, 50 years old playing this part. She is still very, very beautiful. And that's all I have to say about that. I like her character a lot. That she was not in love with her husband, but she was loyal to him. Of course, she says, you know, that, you know, he could trust my silence. And then she just spills the beans completely over the next couple of scenes. She just tells Bond everything. So it's like, well, I guess Spectre was right in that they couldn't trust you. They should have killed you. I'm not sure that I want, you know, I mean, he tells her to go to Felix Leiter, and Felix Leiter will protect her, but it's like, I don't think that Felix Leiter is going to be able to protect her. Apparently they're everywhere and they're going to kill her immediately. But oh well, Bond, I guess she's not exactly, you know, an innocent woman, right? She's complicit in a lot, an awful lot of, her husband's, criminal activity. Even if she wasn't part of the organization. Although one wonders, I mean, not mobsters don't kill dead mobsters' wives. Why would they not necessarily trust her silence? I mean, she would know that if she talked, they would kill her, so she wouldn't talk, right? I mean, I guess they don't have children, so she wouldn't be worried about that so much, but, you know, what was her retirement plan? Did she not think, you know, her husband was going to die someday? He's in a very ugly, dangerous business. So, you know, she hasn't made any effort to disappear and go to the, you know, south of France or something. I don't know. "Leaving your number? I've called an American friend of mine, Felix. He'll contact his embassy and get you out of here. You'll be safe. If you aren't killed in the next 5 minutes." "If you go there, you're crossing to a place where there is no mercy." "I have to go. It's in the script. It's really a dumb idea. I know that. It's really, really dumb idea. I recognize that." This is one of the dumbest things I can think of Bond has ever done, in terms of just something that is just totally inadvisable. The idea that just the ring itself is somehow, he thinks, going to be enough, that it will get him into this super secret meeting of a criminal, international criminal organization. And he's not even wearing a mask, like Eyes Wide Shut or something. I mean, at least put on a mask. All these people really should be putting on masks. I mean, really? He got a very good parking spot, by the way. At showing up late, he still got a really good parking spot. Why is this guy so mean to him? I mean, everybody who shows up here presumably is part of the criminal organization. But, I don't know, maybe you're supposed to show the ring right away? But he's like, oh, no, you got the ring. Like, ooh, I'm shocked that you've got the ring. And he lets him in because clearly this is all planned. Like, there's a guy. If a guy shows up, this is this dude. He's got this ring. He killed Sciara. You remember Sciara? We all liked Sciara, right? They've had a pre... They've had a pre-meeting about this. At least a conference call of some sort. I don't know if Blofeld knows that it's actually Bond at this point. I mean, how much... I mean, Blofeld knows who Bond is because he's been screwing with him for the past four movies. But does he... I don't know. We have placed 160,000 migrated females into the leisure section. Ooh, that doesn't sound healthy. That doesn't sound good. That sounds very bad at all. It's human trafficking. It sounds like human trafficking, is what I'm saying. I don't believe this meeting because I've never been on a perfectly open and above board project where this kind of information was revealed to this full group, let alone an international criminal organization. Surely these reports would be made in private. And the only thing that would be, you know, discussed in a full meeting like this is, you know, just some rah-rah cheerleading. Like, we're on target for this year. We're going to make our numbers. You know, things are looking very positive in the human trafficking market. And I just want everybody to just pull, you know, that little bit harder when it comes to bribes and whether you're giving or taking. Whatever job you have, you know, you do that job just as well as you can, and then we'll all be big successes. And that parking lot that's currently full of really, really expensive cars, you will have even more expensive cars next year. We're all doing really, really well. One of Sciara's duties is outstanding. The Pale King must be terminated. The Pale King... we're going to find out, I guess we're going to find out, is Mr. White, who we've seen in a couple of earlier movies. My loyalty to this organization, I will protect it to my last breath. I will do this murder. I guess we're not going to, no more amateurs now. I'm going to take this on. No more shows of weakness. I'm tired of this. Did we have a lot of shows of weakness before? In the previous films, I guess. Is there somebody else? I don't really like this guy. Why did he get a set all the way at the end of the table? I've told you before, I want him in the second tier. Can you bring in the guy with the thumbs? He should be doing, that'd be great if Blofeld was at his hands up and was doing the thumb squashing the eyeball thing. Could you bring in that guy? What is that guy's name? Jinx? No, Hinks. Jinx? No, Hinks. Yinks? No, Hinks. That is a terrible name. Especially because we had Jinx in the other Die Another Day film. Here we go, Mr. Hinks. Is he even referred to by name? I don't know. And now he's going to kill Dennis Leary. I think that's Dennis Leary. I think. The only way this scene would be better is if that was Dennis Leary. What are your qualifications for being a murderer? I don't know. Show us something, guy, who's gonna trying to prove himself to be a murderer. And that's it? I mean, this is, that's it, huh? So we, like, I don't know, gouge out his eyes with your thumbnails? Oh, and you kill him. Now remember, later on, Blofeld says, you know, we both watched a man's eyes be put out. And remember, he was just lifeless. You know, the life that just went out. There was nobody there. There was nobody in his skull. But no, Hinks clearly broke his neck in that moment. There's no moment where Blofeld looked at that guy and said, look at that. He's, you know, he has no soul anymore since his eyes have been put out. That's a very odd, you know, claim to make later on if that's the way you play that scene. Welcome, James. This is a lot like Eyes Wide Shut. This is really weird because I didn't, like, Blofeld was at the other end of the table, right? Right? Did Bond move? Like, how? Wait, what? How did the situation get this way? Then he turns and says, cuckoo! Like, what the hell? What the hell is that about? And, of course, Bond escapes an international organization of criminals and killers by just jumping out of a window and running away. Yeah, that's their level of security. I guess we're going to shoot at the car. They're really good shots. In the old days, they just would have been really bad shots. But no, nowadays, the car is bulletproof. Of course, not only bulletproof, it doesn't even react to the bullets. There's just like a spark that comes off. They haven't even scratched the paint. There's something about this. You know, there's a point in automobiles when we go from really cool sports car to just basically a race car that drives on the streets. And, you know, the so-called supercar. And it just makes me go, I don't care anymore. I don't care about race cars. I don't care. You know, and the DB10 is just under that. And this other car, I don't know what it is, a McLaren or something. It's just beyond that. It just makes you go, oh, that's some kind of a race car or something. I don't know. Music enabled for 009. That is really a dumb joke. These are also not the kind of cars I would want to go around jumping things. And that's part of the problem, actually, with this sort of a thing. The cars that Bond would have driven in the past in a scene like this were the kinds of cars that you could kind of believe could do, like, rally races, you know? If you want to have a big action car chase that's like a rally race, kind of, you know, with jumping and bumping and this and that, then don't have a car that is basically a Formula One car. You know, you got to have a car that's like a rally car. I'm not saying that you should, you know, be driving Subaru Imprezas or something, but a car that I don't think is going to bottom out on the first bump. That's a little Fiat 500, I think, is what the old man is driving. I'll just call Moneypenny. It's the middle of the night. I don't know what time it is. They're all linked. An organization coordinating multiple attacks. So she was right. I guess they mean M. And I guess that's where I thought it was Ben Whishaw. Like, oh, it's Q sleeping with her. No, go back to sleep. And then it's like, I don't know. Then we could have his cats roaming around. I don't know. Again, I don't think that... I'm not saying that that's what they should have done. But that's sort of what I was expecting. It enriches the relationship between her and Bond, actually, though, and, you know, sort of suggests that there's a, you know, something, we're going to see something more about this later on. I'm bothered by Hinks in a couple of ways. He's a little too ubiquitous. He doesn't have any lines to speak of. I'll get to a little more of that later. You can't drive that road that fast. That's crazy. I mean, come on. Somebody's going to pull out or tread across the street and, you know, that, no. Oh, well. Oh, but so they say, oh, you know, she was right. It was an international thing. Was there more to that tape? Because I did not see the rest of the tape where she says, okay, here's the rest. Okay, I told you to kill that Sierra guy. Here's why. There's an international organization. I think it's called Spectre or something. And they're up to something. And they've got their tentacles everywhere. Don't tell anyone except somebody that you really, really trust, like, I don't know, Moneypenny or something. I'm not going to tell Moneypenny, but if you trust Moneypenny, then you tell her. Like, is there, I guess, the rest of that videotape? Again, I don't believe that those cars would be able to do that without bottoming out and just, you know, utterly wrecking the suspension and literally breaking a wheel off. So you need, if you're going to do that stuff, do it with different cars where I can just buy it a little better. And it's also, in my opinion, it's sort of more fun to do this kind of a thing with cars that are not supercars, because we know that supercars can, you know, drive really fast. So it's kind of more interesting to have a chase with cars that are not meant to do that. We've done that in the past with Bond, where Bond has had chases in cars that are, you know, sort of comical. And that's one thing, but these later Bonds all seem to put him in just basically the superest of supercars that they can get their hands on. And that's that. Air initiated. Pew. A, why is that wall there? Why is that wall there? I mean, presumably there's like that roadway that they were driving on. Presumably that was there so that like maintenance trucks can drive along the river and do maintenance. So why would there be a wall there that stops the maintenance trucks? It looked real, though. I mean, it looked real. It looked pretty real. So there's the young Christoph Waltz. Clearly, father and son feared dead in avalanche tragedy. Blah, blah, blah. In avalanche tragedy, yeah. Oberhauser and his son were believed to blah, 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 blah. Notice how we go from the Spectre criminal meeting directly to, for some reason, a very late night, like a midnight or later, for some reason, British intelligence meeting that is supposed to sort of suggest to us that there's a link between them, in a subtle way. We will now put the resolution to a vote. Ladies and gentlemen, please cast your vote. Let's see. No, South Africa votes no. Well, I guess something, you know, it's a nice country you've got there, South Africa. I sure hope nothing happens to it. This evening's session is ended. I'm really sorry for keeping you so late. Oh my goodness, look, it's after midnight. My goodness. All of our secretaries are probably done having sex with their boyfriends already. But all of our quartermasters are probably still at work, so just give them a call. This is movie logic for you. Nobody sleeps in the movies. Why does he even bother asking, or why does he even bother bringing up the map to figure out where Bond actually is? When the question definitely has to be, where's Bond? The answer is definitely going to be not where he's supposed to be, not in England. And but why does Q not deliver the lie? I mean, he was sort of deliberately going along with the little story when he was talking to Bond earlier. So presumably that was the story he was going to parrot to his boss. But it wasn't. Like, he just immediately went, let me check the chart. Oh, here, yes, look, he's in wherever, you know. What'd he say? Surrey? Sussex? Middlesex? One of the sexes? I don't know where he said he was. I wonder. I can push the door wide open without even having to turn the handle. Why would that be the case? The guy actually does live here, and he's currently at home. Why would he leave the door wide open? Not wide open, but I mean, why would he leave the door, you know, ajar? I guess the idea is he doesn't live here on the main floor. This is all a ruse to fool people. Oh, there's no one lives here. Just the crows. Just some crows live here, I guess. But surely you would close the door. You would close the door and lock the door, because you don't want people wandering in. You want people to have to break in and then go, oh, that it was locked because no one lives here. Because people lock doors when they leave a place and they're not intending to come back for a long time. But of course, then he couldn't have his pet crows flying around. That wouldn't make any sense then. How am I going to explain the pet crows? This is sort of interesting. You know, Bond gets the... Bond notices the secret door. And it's odd that he can open it without alerting the guy. But maybe he didn't. But later on in the hotel, L'Américain, he also notices the secret door there. And... I was gonna say it, and it works because of that, but actually there's no particular thing that draws the connection now that I think about it. Now he's gonna say in a little while that he was poisoned with thallium on his cell phone. Thallium is a genuine poison. It was used for a long time as rat poison. And an ant poison, and it's that poison that is sort of colorless, odorless, tasteless, hard to detect. The symptoms mirror the symptoms of other kinds of diseases and so on. And it really was used to poison people in quite a number of murder cases. An antidote exists, and I forgot what it's called. It's Prussian blue. That's what it is. Prussian blue, the same stuff that is used to make blue paint. Strangely enough, you can take capsules of it and avoid the damage from thallium and certain other kinds of metal poisons. You grew a conscience. Our game is our game. So this is the guy, Mr. White, the Pale King. He was in the Casino Royale. He's the guy who was the money man for Le Chiffre and ended up being the guy who killed him. And he was also in, let's see, he got captured at the end of that, and then he escaped in Quantum of Solace. And then somewhere in between here, we're meant to believe that he had a change of heart and was poisoned by his own organization. Now, why they would poison him instead of just killing him or whatever, I don't know. Because they got this guy who runs around and pokes people's eyes out with his thumbnails. But yeah, they also sometimes poison people for some reason.
You won't find her. She's clever. She's smarter than me. She knows how to hide. She'll disappear. She speaks 12 languages.
And then we cut to the girl wandering around Cairo going, "Does anyone speak English?" No, that would be Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade, sorry.
The word of an assassin. It means nothing to me.
Well, here. Somehow you should trust what I say because I'm giving you a gun? He's alone. He doesn't really shave, doesn't really keep his hair combed or anything, but he does wear a suit jacket with his t-shirt for some reason. Maybe he was just chilly that day. Because this place has to be pretty chilly. You have to figure that. And for the second time, randomly, for reasons I can't quite figure out, Bond gets a bad guy to give him information. Well, not, I mean, I guess the first time wasn't really random. He sexed up Monica Bellucci. So yeah, she sings like a songbird. This guy, you know, he's dying, and I guess he decides he can trust Bond to take care of his daughter, who he is confident has sneaked away and is not, can't be found by the bad guys, because otherwise they would have already found her and tried to use her to get to him. Okay. It doesn't make perfect logic, but it makes enough movie logic that it's okay. I like to imagine that it's this moment that Bond later tries to protect Lea Seydoux from, what's her character's name? Whatever her character's name is. Princess, whatever it is. I don't know. Not the actual moment that her father shoots himself, but it's like, obviously she knows that he's going to shoot himself, but I really don't want her to see me going through his wallet and like, because I pocketed some of that money. He it was no use to him. He had a Subway card with like 11 punches on it. It's like one more punch and you get a free Subway sandwich. So of course I took that. It was almost going to expire. It's not like it would have been any use to her to inherit it. So this is an unfortunate aspect of the film. You know, enough of it relies on these kinds of scenes that we are stuck going, oh, I mean, I can't imagine what the poor set designer was like. Oh, I got to design an office for a British civil servant. Oh, great. Thanks. Another office of a British civil servant. This is meant to be, I suppose, a foil for the office that M has, which is very closed in and full of wood and pictures of ships and whatnot in the traditional sense. I think that's what it looked like, or maybe that's just what it is always in my memory. And this is, you know, it's all glass and very modern and gray and so on. And it's like, okay, well, you did your best. I still am not thrilled by it. There are no, you know, shark tanks or anything. So it's not like I'm going to be impressed. So there you go. Maybe there's something said to be said for total surveillance after all. You watch MI6 agents? I should shoot you now. We watch everyone. No, I should shoot you now. I don't care about the law at this point. This automatically makes you as evil as anybody I've run into in the last 15 years. We watch everybody. Really? The politicians that pay you? You watch them too? Because I think that when I reveal that to them, they're going to go, oh, I'm glad that you killed him because apparently we were employing a supervillain. I mean, that, you know what I mean? That almost makes him as bad as somebody like Blofeld in any way. Now, I must say, these ski pants do not flatter Daniel Craig. But, okay, whatever. And here's another thing. Oh, okay, now I've got to... the poor set designer, right? Now I've got to make an office for a woman who is a, I don't know, psychiatrist? Is that what she is? Yeah, just go right in while she's making notes to herself about her private, I don't know, psychiatric evaluations. Just go right in there. There's no way, also, by the way, that woman in that office is not going to have freezing cold arms. She would be wearing a sweater, a cardigan, a pullover, a jumper, whatever you want to call it. A hoodie, probably a hoodie. That office has got to be freezing cold. It's in the frickin' Alps and it's full of windows. You can't keep a room like that warm without a blazing fire anyway. Do you consider your employment to be psychologically stressful? Sometimes. How much alcohol do you consume? Ooh, too much. This is Lea Seydoux. She has been in quite a bit lately. She's very young. She's literally young enough to be Monica Bellucci's daughter. But she has been in Blue is the Warmest Color. She was in the Grand Budapest Hotel with Ralph Fiennes. I can't remember if they had any scenes together. She was in Inglourious Basterds with the Christoph Waltz, although I don't think they had any scenes together. She was not the main girl. The main girl was Diane Kruger, the one in the second half of the film. She was in Mission Impossible Ghost Protocol. Uh-oh. Crossover. She played Sabine Moreau in Ghost Protocol. So now we're trading. We're reusing our action movie babes. I think I liked her better in Ghost Protocol. I think she was more interesting. This is a very closed off sort of, you know, really closed off. Like, she's a very damaged girl in this film. I think that's supposed to be interesting, but I don't think that she's a particularly good actress. So I feel like that the character doesn't end up coming off very interesting, unfortunately. She has, so far, an absolute monotone delivery. But, oh well. She does okay with what she's given, I suppose. This is, there's something about this, in another Bond film, I feel like I should know who that bartender is, by the way, and I apologize if he's actually somebody, who's been in another Bond film or who's actually a rather famous German actor or something like that. I feel like I should know who he is. He's got a fantastic face, that's for sure. I don't find him credited as bartender, so I don't know who. I don't know how to find him. What was I saying? Oh, so this is the part of the problem with the way this film is structured, or these films in general are structured. This whole scene, this whole sequence is only for the moment. There's nothing about this setting, this office, other than it's just the place where she works. We don't come back to it later on and infiltrate it in the night and discover that there's a secret hideout underneath it or anything like that. There's no attack that happens on the roof or anything like that. It is just in the movie to be the place where she works and where Bond therefore meets her. And that kind of a thing, I feel like that was not done very often in the old Bond films, that they created these places to do a set piece with, to do not necessarily an action scene, but something substantive. Obviously we get a kind of a fight here, but basically this is just the beginning, the kickoff of this chase, and that's kind of as far as it goes. And I feel like in the old days, I feel like they made more of a point of having a reason for a place like this, doing something more with it than what they do here. I mean, particularly here, obviously in other Bond films, we've literally had, fights on the top of these, what, I don't know what you call them. I still know what cable cars, aerial tramways. I don't know what you call them. And we don't do that in this film. So it's a kind of a letdown, and it's unfortunate because of it. I mean, here we're going to have, an action scene that happens in the backseat of a car. And then an airplane chases some cars. Well, we've already had a chase in a car. We've already had a bit of that. How much more of this do we need? The film becomes a little redundant. Now, obviously, it's a different location, different kinds of cars. There's an airplane involved this time. But we already had a helicopter earlier. So, I feel like there's kind of some missteps in the way that they create, the way that they set up the settings and then fail to actually use them or pay them off somewhat. Part of the problem is, I'll tell you this, is that let's say that you were going to make a fan film, a James Bond fan film, and you could get access to an aerial tramway like this because these things exist and you can ride them and you can shoot surreptitiously, kind of shoot your little scene here, and as long as you don't try to shoot any guns, then you could really shoot this for real, right? You could get access to a nice office full of glass and everything, and you could shoot that little discussion scene, and as long as you didn't leave any didn't spill anything on the carpet, nobody would be any the wiser, and they would not mind that you shot something there. You got to know somebody who knows somebody to get access to it, right? And so then you actually do your fan film action scene on a road with cars, and you can have, if you're skilled, you can have a computer generated airplane and whatnot, or you could do with some models or something. And, you're just blowing up a random thing in the middle of nowhere on a road. Well, again, you could do that for a fan film nowadays. That wasn't even that big of an explosion. There's nothing that makes this, that elevates this above a fan film, at the moment. Yes, you'd have to be pretty careful, you know, driving fast in the snow, but come on, is that really that big of a difference between a fan film and a Bond film? There should be an enormous difference between a fan film and a Bond film, and they're kind of, at the moment, for the past, you know, quite a little while, hasn't been. Not that every single action sequence in a Bond film has to be this spectacular thing, and not that they have to blow up every building, but if you think of it in those terms, I think you can kind of feel like, get a feeling for why some of this kind of lays there a little bit. You know, we have this, you know, well, we'll give her a fantastic office. Great. Don't do anything in the office. Just leave the office. And we'll do stuff in, you know, on a snowy mountainside where we don't have to worry about what we're breaking. And then the other problem in a lot of these action films is what happens right here, which is what the, you can, with computer graphics, you can make anything do anything, right? You can make anything happen. And oftentimes what they do in the movies in order to try to make these scenes very spectacular is they have the hero do something that is a really, really terrible idea. There's no logical way. Not only there's there no logical way that he would survive that. I mean, an airplane is not meant to, survive a crash. there's no landing gear there. He's got nothing protecting him from, you know, the thing that he crashes into. There's no crumple zone in a freaking airplane, for Pete's sake. So that was a terrible idea, A, that he would survive that, but it's a terrible idea for him to think that he could survive that. So it's not just audacious, it was just a terrible idea that he happens to survive. And he just pops right out of the plane and you know, starts shooting people as if nothing had happened. Like, that was a crash. You've crashed your airplane. That should not have been something you easily walk away from. That's annoying to me. And why should I trust you? Because my father did? Because right now, Dr. Swan, I'm your best chance of staying alive. Those guys just tried to kill you. So, obviously, it is kind of dumb that she doesn't trust him. Or isn't willing to go with him or whatever. Although his thing is, obviously, that he should immediately put her in hiding and not, you know, allow her to come along with him. And here's I'm here again. The art director is like, oh, now they have a long scene in a hotel room. Yeah. And there's a bunch of dialogue. There's a lot of exposition here. This is basically where they explain this utterly ridiculous DNA match. Did he just do a DNA match to like 9 people from one ring that Bond has been wearing on his own hand for the past several days? Is that what happened? Is that how they cracked the case? Somehow Sciarra recently shook hands with 9 other top henchmen and Blofeld himself, so all their DNA is on the ring? Is that what the movie's explanation is? Because that's stupid. L'Américaine, it's not a person, it's a place. Oh, I never imagined that he kept saying L'Américaine, that it wasn't an actual American. Because I could have asked him what the American's name was if I thought that it was an American, but I didn't think it was an American. I thought it was a place, too. I really should have known that it was not a person. Here it is. L'Américain. It's a hotel. Yep. This is very reminiscent of The Spy Who Loved Me. In good ways. It's a good echo of The Spy Who Loved Me. Not that it lasts long. You remember in The Spy Who Loved Me? when they came into a place like that, that there was somebody got shot and then Bond attacks him and he chase him down and everything. Like there was an they used that place. But they don't use it there. They just go, this is the lobby. It looks nice. Now let's go to a set where we can destroy it. Although even this set is rather nice, I must admit. This is another hotel room, but it's a nice one. It's kind of exotic.
This is where they spent their wedding night. They came back every year. I can't remember my mother's name. She isn't mentioned in the film, I don't think.
But he came back even after the divorce. Well, then I'm sorry, because I am going to tear the crap out of this place. Because I guess that means that this was one of his, I don't know, safe houses? His wife must have died, I guess, right? Because surely they wouldn't have let her live if they were divorced. And she must have been a part of the organization of somewhat. All right, I've torn up 6 things. Gone to the bathroom 3 times. I guess there are a few other things I can tear up, I guess. I cut off all contact. I didn't want anything to do with him, but he knew exactly where I was. Well, he had access to some kind of a surveillance facility. What was that surveillance facility in his hidden basement? Just so he could surveil the area around that abandoned house that he was hiding in the basement of? Or was that some sort of surveillance post? Because it couldn't be one that Blofeld knew about, right? So it's not part of Spectre. It's one that he set up on his own that he could use to surveil the rest of the world for some reason, even though he was out of Spectre. I don't know what that was. I don't know what he was doing. I didn't look closely. Maybe he was playing video games. Maybe he had retired to the basement just to play online first-person shooters. Come anywhere near me and I'll kill you. This is the same woman who literally 15 minutes from now is going to declare her love for him. It's one of the least believable romances in any of the Bond films. Don't think I'm just going to fall into your arms, James Bond. What is she? Is she literally just mumbling liars and killers everywhere? Liars and killers everywhere. Bond has fallen asleep, having given up on the idea of tearing up the rest of the room. He's not really going to shoot a mouse in the middle of the night. Who sent you? That is a very funny joke, I must admit. Who sent you? Who are you working for? And the mouse is a clue. So I guess, since he discovered Mr. White, you know, through that hidden door in the basement, that he came here knowing full well that there was probably a secret room, secret door in here as well. And he's just been thinking about where it was. Now, why he would not have checked this wall already, I don't know. But and also, the other question is, why this doorway would be plastered over? Like, who would have done that? Not the hotel, right? It would have been Mr. White himself? Maybe, I guess. And done a really poor job of plastering it over. Even though it's lath and plaster, and it should be like an inch thick and harder than any human hand, he manages to punch right through it. Now, I mean, it's lath and plaster, right? It's not just drywall. I mean, that's what you would do today. You would put up some. You would put up a couple of 2x4s and put some drywall over it, and you wouldn't. You know, you'd be able to break through that very easily. But you don't. I guess wherever this is, they still do lath and plaster. They just do it really, really thin. Maybe they do it every year. Maybe the hotel does it. Maybe the hotel is part of the whole Blofeld's organization, and every year they come here and he breaks that, you know, Mr. White used to break this open and use this for like a weekend, just to, you know, like a long weekend. Well, no, he's European, right? So a 6-week summer vacation, the entire month of August, I guess. I forget that I'm American and I have this a bit of a perspective on vacations. So yeah, he would use it for 6 weeks and then they would plaster it over again. Badly. Vesper Lind interrogation. See, he was involved until recently. Like, well, I guess there's still enough time for like dust to settle in this place. But he was still recording stuff on VHS in 2006. What's this random piece of paper? Out of all the piece of papers pinned up on the wall in this room, I pick this random one that I don't recognize. What is this? What are all these random numbers? Coordinates.
He was looking for him, and he sent me here to do the rest of the job. Oh. He wants me to find Mr. White wanted Bond to find Blofeld. I guess that's what he's saying. But again, and he didn't know where Blofeld was, I guess is what he's saying.
And Bond is going to use this magically to finish the job?
Okay, well, I'm going to look up these coordinates that he wrote down conveniently on a 3x5 card. Nowhere. And here we are at another meeting. Oh, the meeting was brought forward. You didn't get the memo. Oh, this is the same thing they did to Dumbledore. But Dumbledore was too quick for him. He arrived early.
I don't even like the way Andrew Scott walks. There's something weaselly about the way he walks. In light of new information I've given to him, he's decided to close down the 00 program with immediate effect. We don't need quote-unquote men to quote-unquote shoot people anymore. We have drones for that.
You're a cocky little bastard, aren't you?
I'll take that as a compliment.
I wouldn't, because I don't like you. This is an interview, and I'm going to get over here. I mean, just don't, you mumble. I say, by Jove.
That's what he should say. Ray finds M should say, by Jove. Oh, here we are on a train. Hooray, a train. We haven't been on a train for a while. When's the last time we were on a train? Well, I can't remember the last time we were on a train. We might have been it might have been Quantum of Solace, actually, now that I think about it. Soon, not right away. Oh, she's going to show him a little trick here. Where, like, I know how guns work. I hate guns, but I know how guns work. I wasn't the daughter of an international assassin for nothing, you know. I said I hate guns. SIG 226. Why is he carrying a SIG 226? Why would he give her that gun instead of his Walther PPK? Because he's carrying a Walther PPK these days. A train is really a great place to get firearm training, by the way. Not before. Not in the desert. Later. Let's practice now on the train. Well, you push the wrong button. Oh, I guess you already know how to rack the action. I don't have to teach you anything, do I? How about the knife fighting part? A man once came to my house to kill my father. He didn't know I was upstairs playing in my bedroom. I was 4 years old, and I took Papa's Beretta 9mm from under the sink in the kitchen. I shot him 9 times. He says, we can skip the hand-to-hand combat, and she smiles there, but I think the Bond thing to do would be to suggest, let's move directly to hand-to-hand combat. I think he would not want to skip that part, actually. That would be the part that he would suggest moving on to right away. Again, the poor art director. It's a restaurant. It's like an old school British, military man's favorite restaurant. It's not quite a pub, but it's clubby. It's a kind of a men's club style restaurant. Yeah, those exist. We'll just shoot in one that's real. You're not going to blow it up, are you? No, we're not going to blow it up. We're just going to do a little scene there and then leave. All right, well, I'll just find one then. I'm not going to build it. You shouldn't stare where you shouldn't look like that. We're about to come up on the next scene with Hinks. The actor's name is Dave Bautista. According to Wikipedia, the character is based on Red Grant from Russia with Love, but that is not true. I don't know where they got that, probably from, the press release or something. I don't know why anyone would claim that, because it is totally, that is just unfactual. There's no way that that's true. Clearly, the character is based on Jaws from The Spy Who Loved Me. Red Grant was not a great big guy. He was basically as big as Connery was, as big as Bond. He was athletic and muscly, but he wasn't a big bear of a guy. Jaws was, and Dave Bautista is, a great big guy. Jaws had the metal teeth. Hinks has the metal thumbnails, which is really kind of dumb, but whatever. But he's got the metal thumbnails, and that's his gag. His shtick. They have a fight on the train now. Yes. Bond had a fight on the train with Red Grant in From Russia with Love, but he also had a fight on a train with Jaws in The Spy Who Loved Me. And Jaws survived that. And guess what? I think Hinks is going to survive this encounter. Call me crazy, but I think he's going to come back in another film. Because he's a pretty good character. He's not he's not a great character, I don't think, but he's pretty good. Here he is right now. And everything about this fight feels like the way Bond was fighting Jaws, not the way Bond was fighting Red Grant, which is a great scene, by the way. It remains a really tough, brutal, really good fight. It stands up, I think, pretty well, even to stuff the Bourne movies and the newer Bond movies and the Mission Impossible movies and stuff like that. It's just a really, really well done fight in close quarters. This feels like what we saw in The Spy Who Loved Me, where Bond is outmatched physically and he's just trying to keep himself from being killed until he can put himself in a position where he can kind of outsmart the bad guy and kind of lure him into a place where he has a chance of defeating him. And then the last bit of my evidence for who the character is based on is the fact that when we do dispatch him, he gets dispatched in what is essentially a visual pun on the film Jaws, because he gets attached to some barrels and they go popping off the train in the same way that the barrels went popping off the boat in Jaws when they harpooned the shark and the shark was pulling down those barrels. So it's really a little too obvious. There's also a bit of odd job in this. Remember how Bond was really quite intimidated by odd job and that actually made him a more interesting character because it was clear that Bond knew that he was physically outmatched and made it a little more fun. And there's certainly some of that in here as well. But I think Jaws, in certain ways, Jaws is also kind of based a little bit on that same character. Remember also, Jaws had like a sidekick got thrown off a building. Remember that? Dropped off a building at one point. That was helpful to that film as well, that we had a guy that Bond could kill. And there we go. There goes one of the barrels. And we've got the rope wrapped around his neck here. And the barrel's going off one by one. And he gets dragged down. But, much like the shark Jaws in Jaws, I think we're going to see Thumbnails again, or whatever his name is. Hinks. God, that's a terrible name. Such a terrible name. Now, for some reason, suddenly, she's totally in love with him and wants to have his sex. Come on, have my sex. Let's go. Right now. I really don't know why, because shouldn't they be afraid that there are other bad guys on the train? I mean, nobody stopped that fight. Nobody has even questioned them. Like, what are you doing? Why did you just kick a guy off this train? What are you, crazy? Where did all of our beer kegs go? Who's responsible for this outrage? Or then again, perhaps they actually did get caught and this was the result of it. Like, just get off this train right now. Get off. I don't care if there's nothing here. You are gone, mister. So again, they don't think, like, they're trying to track, they're going, as far as they know, into the middle of nowhere to see what is at those coordinates. Now, call me crazy, maybe a train is not the way to go to the middle of nowhere. Maybe an airplane is the way to go to the middle of nowhere. Call me crazy. But that's how you get somewhere that you will then be able to get back. You don't take a train to the middle of, almost the middle of nowhere, to the edge of nowhere, and then go, I hope a car shows up. Because there's no Uber drivers at this point. There's no, you can't get an Uber helicopter here. A 1948 Rolls-Royce Silver Wraith, I think is what he just said. A lovely car. It's nice. It's the only time in like three movies that Bond has ever shown his, his bon vivant side. Like, can you, God, have you read the books? All the time Bond is talking about, the best food, the best wine, the best this and that. And, he's a connoisseur of sorts. Not born, not to the manner born, but certainly educated. A little, not snobbish. Snobbish is probably the wrong word, but certainly, prefers the nicer things in life, appreciates the finer things. And we don't really get that with Daniel Craig's Bond, hardly at all. He doesn't seem to even, remember in the old days, Bond would like spout off all kinds of knowledge about things. And I would point out that that's easy to do if you're the one bringing up the subject. And it's much harder to do if someone else brings up the subject and you're trying to like think of like, what do I know about that? Oh, what do I know about? What do I know about the diamond trade? What do I know about how sherry is made? All right. Good afternoon, Mr. Bond, Ms. Swan. We're excited to meet you all. We've heard so much about you. We've been talking about you. Relax. Join him for drinks at 4 o'clock. Tell our host we won't be late. Ah, wonderful, wonderful. Did this guy introduce himself? Why, this is, who's this guy? he's the gun butler. Now, when they arrive, he's going to have a gun. I'm going to ask you to buttle his gun. You know what to do. You're the usual gun butler. Because, it is kind of believable, because Blofeld probably has all kinds of horrible criminals come to visit him all the time. And he's got to have a gun butler to get the people's guns, whoever they are. Ah, there's the picture. There's his copy of the picture. Somehow he actually kept a good copy of it. That actually, you know what? That actually does not look all that much like Christoph Waltz. So I think we might have been okay seeing that picture with his head intact. Although, I really hate the idea of knowing so much about Bond's background, and he had, he's brought up with this in this foster family, and his brother hated him and stuff like that. Yes, Bond was an orphan and must have been raised by someone, and went into the military. That it sounds like he had a pretty good childhood, though. despite losing his parents when he was, 10 years old or something. That guy taught him mountain climbing and all this other stuff. And it's like, and he liked him. He liked him more than his own son. That sounds like a pretty good childhood to me. Why did Bond turn out to be the person that he is? Because he seems like the kind of person who has overcome his childhood, not the sort of person who enjoyed a pleasant childhood. Yes, there's tragedy. Of course there's tragedy. Yes, I'm sorry. Yes, of course there's tragedy. If you've lost your parents in a mountain climbing accident, I am very sorry. I don't mean to make light of it. I'm not making light of that particular loss. Naturally, that's going to have echoes in his later life, but it doesn't turn you into James Bond. And as you well know, unless you are, again, an international assassin, I've apologized to international assassins before, and I'm going to continue apologizing to international assassins. Let me tell you why. I'm afraid of them. So if you're an international assassin and you listen to my commentaries on the James Bond movies, specifically to get, insights, into how to be a better international assassin or something, recognize that in no way would I disparage your profession or personality type. So this is a meteorite that was once a meteor and fell out of the sky and landed on the ground and became a meteorite. That's, I think, where those terms, I think I'm using those terms correctly. Is there a theme? I don't quite get, it would be interesting if he called that meteorite Skyfall or something like that. I don't think that's the case. I don't think there's any tie-in, really. I came to your home once to see your father. You shot the man that I was with. You were 4 years old, and you got out the Beretta, and you shot him. You must know by now the 00 program is officially dead. Which leads me to speculate exactly why you came. So, James, why did you come?
I came here to kill you.
Wow, that's some clever dialogue, isn't it? No, it's not. It's not really very clever or interesting or... I'm not sure what the purpose of that was, even. We're not moving things along. We're not explaining anything. Not very good dialogue. This is, I feel like this is an inefficient room. The idea here is that, we're monitoring the world's security cameras. You know, all 100 of them? Some of these screens have, 12 different camera views on them. But that one of the director's office there, MI6 office, had like four cameras that was all, all in the same office. You're not really seeing, you've got to have 100 rooms like this to even have a remote chance of being able to, I don't know, what do you think you're going to find? It just seems like you've got access to so much information, you can't possibly monitor it all. So you have to have what the NSA actually has, which is a giant server farm that electronically monitors stuff and just looks for keywords coming through email and telephone conversations and everything else. It's crazy. What Edward Snow revealed to the world, frankly, terrifying. And that's what this movie is playing on. If you didn't know, I urge you to look it up. It's a terrifying idea that our government is spying on us, and they're quite casually going, we'll just gather everything. We'll just spy on everything. But we're only looking for bad stuff. We're only looking for bad stuff, and we'll never, ever use it in a way against our own citizens in a way that would be considered unethical or illegal. Because we specifically figured out a way to make it legal, even though it's decidedly, really very clearly unconstitutional, definitely illegal search and seizure, definitely, definitely illegal search and seizure, spying on our own citizens. Anyway, there's no possible way you can use people to accomplish anything. And these people are just kind of looking at monitors full of, some of it appears to be data and some of it appears to be camera feeds. And I can't imagine what, the information he should be looking for is information on like business deals that he could then profit from using insider trading. And other than that, almost nothing else has, as far as I can think of, any conceivable value to him. If you spy on negotiations between countries, that the only piece of information that is any of any value is the result of that negotiation. And that result of that negotiation is going to be announced very quickly because they don't want it to leak exactly in the way that he is trying to accomplish. So there's very little that this kind of thing, I think, would really, very little value that this would really have to him. Other than, like, the very specific things that he actually shows us, which is, look, I can spy on MI6 headquarters, and we can, you know, we can hear what they publicly announce in MI6 headquarters? I don't know. How valuable is that? So here is here's the moment where, you know, she's sort of forced to watch her father kill himself. And I like the way that Bond sort of says, look, just don't look at it. And she trusts him enough that she's just going to look at Bond and try not to. I like that line, that you're a kite dancing in a hurricane. I think that might actually come from an Ian Fleming novel. I can't remember for sure. I know I've heard it somewhere else before, but it's a good line, and that's a nice moment. It's also very interesting the way that the video actually portrays Bond in a very good way, and I think it would have been interesting if in that moment that her father killed himself, that she could have said to Bond or mouthed to him or something, thank you, or something like that, explicitly acknowledging that Bond was truthful with her and fulfilled his promise to her father and that kind of thing. And that's the moment that she actually would fall in love with him, when she realized that everything that he's been telling her has actually been true. Even though he's an international assassin spy, he's actually been totally on the level with her. That would have been kind of neat. And a kind of an emotional, a bit of emotional color that we didn't get from Bond in other cases or in other areas, and that would fill out the character a little bit, that he doesn't have a specific reason to lie to her or use her, and therefore he's 100% on the level with her, or even. He's on the level with her because he promised her father to be on the level with her or whatever. I think that would have been actually, you know, that might have been what they were trying to do with that moment, but I think it would have been more interesting if it were a little more explicit. So this is one of those things where it's like, you know, what, how about if he, naturally he's going to torture Bond. Because he's kind of been torturing him from a distance all along. And, okay, so now he's going to torture him. Like, what would be a really horrible torture? Oh, nobody would want, you know, a dentist drill, like, drilled into their skull. Like, that would be fun. But it's not. It's kind of not fun. I don't know. It's one of those things. I don't know. And also, it doesn't seem to hurt Bond in any way. I mean, it's painful when it's happening, but it doesn't seem to have any lasting effect. And he's like, I'm going to, you know, drill into your cortex and I'm going to, you know, remove your memory of human beings and you're not going to remember any person. And then, but he does remember her, and then nothing seems to come of it. I think that at first here, all he's trying to do is cause pain, and he was successful at that. But it's, you know, I don't know. It's kind of pointless. It's not torture. It's not torture with a reason. He's not trying to get any information. He's just trying to cause him pain. And if that's the case, then why do it in such a weirdly sort of clinical style? But did you know that it was my father who helped him through the difficult time? Of course, over the course of 2 winters, he taught him to ski, climb, and hunt. He soothed the wounds of the poor little blue-eyed orphan. I'm not sure why a German would be prejudiced against someone with blue eyes, but whatever. 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 My little brother. So, I don't... So, my problem with Christoph Waltz is, although he's a very good actor, he for some reason has decided to have this this American accent, and to suppress his Austrian accent. I don't know if he's trying to not sound like Arnold Schwarzenegger or what. I don't imagine that they share the same. I think my understanding is that Schwarzenegger's accent is like this rural Austrian farm boy accent, and he sounds like a hillbilly to Germans. I don't imagine that Waltz has that accent because he was born in Vienna. But anyway, he seems to be very proud of his English, but he has this very precise, in an avalanche alongside his father. The man you are talking to now, the man inside your head, is Ernst Stavro Blofeld. He just has this weird mannerism in the way that he talks. And in when we first saw him in Inglourious Basterds, that was weirdly creepy because he was playing a Nazi and everything. And I think his accent was thicker in that. But since then, he has, you know, I think continued to suppress it. And not only that, but he's suppressed the theatricality of some of his other performances in Django and the other areas. And this is the place to unleash that, if anywhere. Now, maybe they're trying to say, okay, well, he's going to get away because he gets like arrested or whatever. So obviously he's going to escape and he's going to come back again. You don't throw away Blofeld in one film. I think in the books, I think that every time he came back, he looked different. So they might play with that. They might have another character. Well, of course, this one hasn't changed his look, so I don't think they're actually going to change his look. I mean, in the books, Blofeld, if nothing else, is famous for changing his looks. And here, he looks exactly the same when he was a kid as he do now. I mean, so they're not going that way with this character. But for whatever reason, yeah, he's playing this character as not very crazy. And in the books, he kind of went crazy over when he came back again and again. So maybe their intention is that he plays the character more and more crazy. I guess maybe, but he leaves me cold in this film. He could be better, I think. I also have a real problem with the idea that I am certain I could not set the alarm on my watch without looking at it, and yet Bond manages to set the alarm on a watch that's A, strange, and B, a bomb. With no apparent practice. I mean, it's not like we saw him earlier practicing. Doesn't time fly? Throw the bomb! Throw the watch! He just looks at it. Huh? And again, this is not the first time we've seen it in the other films. Bond fails to make sure that Blofeld is actually dead. For no reason. He kind of had plenty of time there. He at least had a few seconds, for sure. For sure. But no. He just immediately runs out. I'll need that. This is kind of a rare moment for Bond. I guess it's happened before, but Bond does not typically walk around wielding automatic weapons and just mowing dudes down, Mac Bolan style. There's a reference for you. Why does that blow up? Why does that blow up? Like, everything blows up. Everything there seems to be made out of concrete, and yet everything blowed up. Just blowed right up. And yet, Blofeld somehow got out. Blofeld himself blowed up, and then everything around him blowed up, and now, and yet, somehow, he's still alive. Bond apparently not smart enough to bother to destroy those other helicopters. Because, you know, somebody could go and get in one and chase you, but, oh well, whatever. We didn't get a smirk that time. We should get another smirk. Every time he steals a helicopter from the bad guys, he should smirk. I got another helicopter. I like to imagine that he's got that original helicopter from the Day of the Dead Carnival in his basement parking spot in his apartment building. It's mine now. I got it. It's mine. I'm keeping it. So here we are, we're all meeting at the safe house, which has an exterior staircase, because, you know, that's safe, I guess? It's safe. Oh, except that Bond is already here. Yeah, I knew I shouldn't have, this is a terrible idea. This is full of windows, and it has an exterior staircase. This was not a good place to meet. Chief of Intelligence, his new best friend, C, about to take control of very own global surveillance system that he built right under our noses. I brought all this ammunition and these guns, and I didn't bother putting the ammunition in the guns. I didn't put the magazines in the guns until now. I figured we would do that now, when we're inside the building. Instead of on the drive over or anything like that. Good to have you back, 007. It kind of would have been fun there if somehow, if Bond had delivered the video of Judi Dench's M to Ralph Fiennes's M, and if then it would have been clear that Bond was never gone. He was never rogue. He was only away from Ralph Fiennes's office because he couldn't trust them. And if he had said that then specifically, I'm sorry, I couldn't trust you before, but I trust you now, you know. And now I know where we stand. And then he could say, it's good to have you back, Bond. And Bond could have said something like, thank you, sir. But I've never been gone. It would be nice, you know. I like the Britishness, it would be nice if Bond, acknowledged that he serves Her Majesty the Queen, and if there was some kind of explicit indication. There's a moment at the end when Ralph Fiennes arrests Blofeld, like, in the name of the Queen or something like that. And it's a kind of a strangely charmingly British kind of thing. I don't know if that's the actual way that it would have been done, if it's even possible for the head of MI6 to arrest someone. I don't know how that works. But it's a charming moment. Charmingly British moment. Also, notice we had that little meeting in that room in the terrible place to meet, and then we left it. We didn't do anything there. We just left it. And now we have our action sequence, again, on the road, in the middle of nowhere, in a place where it doesn't matter how much damage we do to the walls that are made of concrete. We could blow stuff up on that random road in the middle of a snowy forest, and we can crash cars here in the middle of a, like, concrete tunnel. We spend our money on a couple of fake building collapsing scenes. But, yeah, we're not going to blow stuff up for real. poor Q. Can you imagine Desmond Llewellyn, the old Q, trying to hack into the computer system? Oh, Lord. No, he's the guy who comes, he's got machine guns built into, you know, brassieres and stuff. That's what he does for a living. But no, this Q is the poor Ben Whishaw is like, oh, here I am. I'm Q. I'm hacking into our own computer system. I'm hacking into computer systems. Okay, it's a seamless edit to you, but I just had to pause and take my dog out for a walk. And I've completely forgotten what I was talking about. Which is okay, because it's probably nonsense. I think I may have been talking myself into not liking this movie. This is a perfectly adequate entry in the series. It's a good, exciting film. In the modern action film secret agent world style, of which there are only like maybe two or three, maybe. Is the Bourne series still going? I guess that's still going. So I guess three. I forgot to mention also, when I was talking about Dave Bautista, he was in Guardians of the Galaxy. He plays Drax in Guardians of the Galaxy. And the reason that that is relevant is because I did not care for his performance in Guardians of the Galaxy. Specifically, the way that he dealt with dialogue. So I guess, because I do like him in this film, that the filmmakers here made a good choice by not giving him any dialogue. I think he has one word of dialogue. So this point of the film becomes a little bit confusing because we have the character of C going to his office, which is in a completely different building from the one that Bond is in. Bond is in the old MI6 office that got blown up in the other movie, and it's going to get further blown up. They're going to blow up that movie, that set a couple of times, actually. They might blow it up again in the next movie, for all we know. I don't know. But we're going to try to stop Max Denby. Boy, that's a legendary... Can you imagine what Ian Fleming would have said about the name Max Denby as a bad guy character? The man who invented Emil Largo. Ernst Stavro Blofeld. Dr. No. He liked to take names, actually, from real people. And actually, Blofeld was the name of a man that he went to school with. He borrowed that name and others. It's weird then that Eon lost the rights to use Blofeld to McClory because clearly if you can show that, you know, Ian Fleming and Kevin McClory worked on Thunderball together. And they came up with a character named Blofeld, and Ian Fleming went to school with a guy named Blofeld, then obviously, you know, that character apparently is mostly, or at least largely, the creation of Ian Fleming. That's a good little bit there. Now we know what C stands for. Careless. It's clever because it... obviously, it's not the C word that the audience was thinking of, for the most part. But depending on who you are, you may not be thinking of that particular C word. And you may just have no idea what C word he's talking about. Until he says, careless. I don't know why there's a new system online countdown screen you can keep referring back to. It'll be online in 5 minutes and 46 seconds. And what does being online mean? Isn't everything, you know, it all has to work together, right? Now, wait a minute. It just occurred to me. How is that character? Oh, boy. I gotta think this through. But first I have to remember who these people are. Okay, in Skyfall. Casino Royale, blah, 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 blah. Bond 25 is coming up. Casino Royale. Oh, wait a minute, where's Skyfall? Quantum of Solace. Skyfall. My wounds will heal. What about yours? My wounds, I'm pretty good with my wounds. My wounds are actually pretty fine. Except for Vesper. I mean, that kind of hurts a little bit, but it's not like a giant scar on my face. The scar is from, Teddy Savalas's version of the character, if I remember correctly. Oh, for the sake of Pete. Got some chocolate here. Okay. Javier Bardem's character, Raul Silva. I'm never going to remember that. The MI6 operative turned cyber terrorist. Somehow he was involved in Spectre? Because we saw his face there. Like, how? Really? I didn't like that character. I've really put you through it, haven't I? That's brothers for you. They always know which buttons to press. That's like a Mel Brooks villain. It works. It works because of the tag, I suppose. A little silly. But you've got Bond here in a giant death trap. Which I don't think we've kind of done that before, right? Is put Bond in a death trap where he can freely run around, but he just is going to have a tough time accomplishing what he wants to accomplish before he tries to get out. That's kind of clever. Blofeld calls for another helicopter Uber. And he's going to lose another one. We don't even see him fall. We just see some broken glass. I mean, again, you could just about film this as a fan film. Yeah, we got some candy glass. It was kind of expensive. It was like $100. And anyway, you're gonna shoot the gun, and I'll just put in the noise and the flash later in the After Effects or whatever that thing is called. And then we'll drop the candy glass on you, and it kind of broke in a couple of pieces, but it doesn't matter because it's all shattering. So we're just gonna, you know, just gonna dump it on you, and then he has to fall down. But we got the mattress down there, so he'll fall on the mattress, and then you'll look over the edge, and we'll put him down. We'll cut. And we'll have a like we'll put him down on the floor. Yeah, that sounds like that'll work. That'll be good. So let me get this right. He was running all through the building screaming her name. And it's only when he randomly, accidentally showed up in the room right next to hers that she decides to scream. Like, oh, there she is. It's not like he ran there because she was screaming. Do you trust me? This is crazy. So this thing, my understanding of these building demolitions is that this is something that's meant to catch falling debris, but I don't know why. Because obviously the whole building is going to collapse in on itself. So I think the idea is that you protect what you're really doing is protecting the later charges from debris caused by the initial charges. I think that's what that net is for. Bond has, of course, ruined it, and now the building is not going to collapse correctly, theoretically. The Demolition Man has a real building demolition in it. They actually filmed a big hardware store, like the headquarters of a great big hardware company, Belknap, I think is the name of it, in, I think, Cincinnati. And it was this enormous headquarters that was also a huge warehouse that was like the central location for the company. That was like a supplier to other, regular mom and pop hardware stores. And for whatever reason, bad management, this old company, 100 years old or something, went out of business, and they were going to demolish the building, and they used that in that film. Nowadays, of course, you can destroy anything you want, anytime you want, just bring it down with computer graphics. And as a result, you don't have all the extra stuff all around it that you have to do for real, you know? I mean, that was supposed to be a detonation. That was supposed to be an actual purposeful demolition. So they should have had, like, klaxons going off, and there should have been lots of workers around, and why are they doing it at night? Wouldn't they do it during the day? whatever. Here we go. Again, we're losing the helicopter. Blofeld, brace, brace, brace. Blofeld is like, I don't even have anything to hold on to. I think you could have done a better job. I think I could have done a better job bringing that helicopter down safely. I don't like to, Uber is a fine company. But its drivers are not professional drivers, and it's, by extension, its helicopter pilots would not be professional helicopter pilots. They're just people who happen to own a helicopter, and they want, it's, a helicopter is an expensive thing to own, and they want to get some use out of it, and some airtime, and make some money to offset the cost. Let me clarify. I don't own a helicopter. I've never tried to fly a helicopter, but I think I could have done a better job bringing it down more safely than that. Basically just a crash, frankly. This is kind of pathetic. I'll tell you, when he's trying to get out, there's a kind of a thematic problem there, because no matter what, when you see someone trying to escape a crashed vehicle, just automatically, viscerally, your reaction is, any sane human being anyway, your reaction is, I hope he gets out. But this is the bad guy. I don't want him to get out. I want him to die in a crash or something. So I think it's kind of a mistake to show us that. And then he's like crawling away. It's all injured and pathetic. And it's like, well, you know, you can't kill him now. I mean, he's not armed or anything. This is pathetic. You got to bring him into custody. So it's not like we could actually imagine Bond was going to do this. It's kind of dumb. But on top of it, it has the problem that I've complained about in the same film and other films, which is an automatic weapon, an autoloader, a pistol, you know when it's out of bullets because the action is racked back. But here, he has to actually, unload the thing and go, "Look, I'm out of bullets." Nah, that's not how guns work, man. It's like every screenwriter thinks all guns are revolvers. I've got something better to do. I could just kick you to death. Although, you know what would be funny? What actually would have been kind of joyous is if he had said, you are right. Dad always did like me best. And then walk away. He told me personally he liked me and wished that I was his real son instead of you. Because he knew you were a shit from the get-go. That would have been fun. If actually he turns around the brotherly rivalry and needles him with it. Yeah, your father was a good man. He genuinely liked me more than he liked you. All we need is Ving Rhames jumping in the air and in the background and, punching the air. Yeah! Our hero's gonna get married now. What? Wait, what? This is not the way a spy movie should end. That is not the way a spy movie should end. Was that Mission Impossible 3, I think? That should not have ended that way. That's not a way a spy movie should end. But this, that walking, just walking away hand in hand, that's okay. That's a good spy. In fact, it's kind of a John le Carré moment, really, in a way. Not that I've literally seen any John le Carré film or read literally any John le Carré book other than The Spy Who Came In for the Cold. I think I saw that once. It was 1979. I wasn't sure what I was watching. I was confused and frightened. But the feeling I still remember from that moment 35 years ago is, yeah, that's about right. There's just one thing I need. First, can we turn on some lights here? Why are you working in the dark? And then second, I need for you to give me another car. So this is the DB5 that is reminiscent, obviously, of the one from Goldfinger. But it's the one he had. He supposedly won this version of Bond, won this car in Casino Royale in like a poker game. It was owned by the bad guy, one of the bad guys. And he drives it the rest of the movie. And it came back later, and then he ended up driving it in Skyfall, and it got destroyed when he drove it up to Skyfall, and the bad guys attacked it, and it was, I think it blew up. I think they shot it. I think it shot with machine guns. I don't remember. You go back and watch that movie, and listen to my commentary while I explain what's happening while it's happening. I can't be expected to remember these things every 2 years, like clockwork. Or to bother go back and watch them before doing another commentary. Maybe I should have done that. One could argue that that would in fact be the case. All right, well, that was the film. It's 2.5 hours long, and it was good, and it had some parts that would go. I wanted this to be delicious. I wanted Spectre to be delicious. I wanted to relish the wickedness of Blofeld, I wanted the emotional impact of this buildup of this chain of events that where all of these people that not all of them, but many of these people that Bond had been struggling against, it turns out, were all being controlled by a puppet master in the background, and he's even controlling a puppet master. He's puppeting someone right now. You know, this maybe is the right place for a character who's an insider gone bad, if you're going to have one. But it wouldn't be necessary, because Blofeld can just be an international terrorist and not necessarily a puppet master. But sure, yeah, I mean, he's got bad guys all around. They're doing all kinds of crazy things. And I wanted that kind of to be an emotional impact in that respect. Like, you know, just, I had no idea. You were behind all these things. Jimmy Savile, even. Oh, ah, damn. Oh, and somehow, I don't know. That's my proposal. And it wasn't as meaty as I wanted it to be. It had some good stuff in it. Some of it could have been shot by teenagers with a borrowed Red camera. And, you know, I don't need it to be bigger. It was, I think it was, like, ridiculously expensive for some reason. And I don't know why. Because it had a lot of helicopters. I'll say that. It had its share of helicopters. There's no denying that. But other than that, where was the money? I mean, there were a couple of buildings that fell down in the computer. And a couple of secret rooms in abandoned places. And there was a large desert facility of some sort that appeared to explode for random reasons. So that was, I guess, kind of big. But, I mean, realistically, that must have been a set. But no, I mean, that was all done on a computer. They didn't really blow that up, right? Maybe they did. I mean, if they spent $250 million, they probably blew it up for real, I guess. But they didn't have to. I don't know. Of course, I don't know, maybe they paid Daniel Craig, like, a ridiculous amount of money, because apparently the rumor is that in order to get him to come back for another film, they offered him $100 million. Now that would probably be salary plus a portion of the gross or something like that. But that's freaking Tom Cruise money, man. And I don't see Daniel Craig commanding that. There are guys lining up to play James Bond who are going to be very good, like Tom Hiddleston or somebody. You know, Idris Elba is a little too old at this point, but he would have been a really good choice. And there are other choices along the way. Who's the most recent one that was talking about she wanted to play Bond? Gillian Anderson was talking about, like, only half jokingly, saying that she would like to play Bond. She's also getting a little bit too old. She's 47 years old. That's not old. That's not old at all. She's not very old. 47 is not old, you people. I don't know why you would even say that or think that, but she's mature. She's certainly mature. But there are plenty of people that you could get to play Bond. And as much as I like Daniel Craig, he's not like my favorite Bond of all time. So, but he is. I mean, he's made them a hell of a lot of money. There's no doubt about that. I mean, that's how they do these things. They go, well, he seems to be popular. Let's just, whatever it takes to keep him, to keep this thing going. They are a bit conservative at the Bond franchise, and they do change. They don't want to change horses in midstream, especially if that stream is a giant river of money. So I guess that's understandable. And I can't blame him for it. So, you know, best of luck to them. And I look forward to the next Bond film, whether it's Daniel Craig or really almost anyone else. I mean, not anyone else. I mean, not like Rosie O'Donnell or something. I don't want to watch a Bond film with Rosie O'Donnell. official. Ellen DeGeneres, though. Ellen DeGeneres could play Bond. She would introduce like a little dancing bit for Bond. I think that would work. All right. Thanks for listening.